Metabolic syndrome affects 43% of adults in the US. The definition of metabolic syndrome is having at least three among abdominal obesity, high fasting blood sugar, high blood pressure, high triglycerides, and low HDL cholesterol. If you have three or more of those, you have metabolic syndrome, and it's bad news for health. So a team of scientists set out to test if you can reverse metabolic syndrome just with a healthy lifestyle. They took over 600 participants with metabolic syndrome and they split them randomly. Half got the full lifestyle intervention. For 6 months, they attended group meetings with the other participants where a psychologist and a dietitian led those sessions and gave them all kinds of information on a healthy lifestyle. They focused on building four habits, including vegetables at meals, taking brisk walks, sensory awareness, that's basically being aware of smells, tastes, colors, so being more in the moment. And finally, emotional regulation, which is basically building the habit of pausing before you react to stress automatically and not falling into opportunistic eating. So basically, psychological tools to be in charge, to be less reactive and less likely to eat reflexively. The goal is that eating becomes a conscious decision that you're aware of and you're in control of. They also got an activity monitor, a Fitbit that tracks their movement to keep them accountable and to motivate them to move more, to exercise more. So that was half of the participants got this full intervention. The other half were sort of a control group. They got the Fitbit as well. And they also got monthly tip sheets sent to them with some lifestyle advice, but not those group meetings, so not the full intervention. So it's not really an intervention and a completely control group. It's really two interventions, one more intense and one less intense, and we'll see why that matters a little later. Over the 6 months of the trial, most behaviors did change in the participants, so good news. They increased their vegetable intake, daily steps, and sensory awareness. Several of those habits they were trying to reinforce. Emotional regulation was the only one that did not change significantly. Didn't stick. At the end of the 6 months, 1 in 4 of the participants no longer had metabolic syndrome. They put it in remission. So that's a good result. It's not an amazing result. Could have been more, but pretty respectable. 25% of people solved the issue or greatly improved it. We're going to look in a second at how this could have been done better to get a more impressive result. The control group, that less intense intervention, they also saw an improvement. 17% put metabolic syndrome in remission. So both interventions worked. The more intense intervention got stronger results. Makes sense, right? As far as individual metrics, waist circumference, triglycerides, fasting glucose, BMI, body weight, and hemoglobin A1C were all lower on the more intense intervention group than the quote-unquote control group. Okay, so far, interesting. Next, the investigators asked, can these people hold on to the benefits long-term? This is a crucial question because seeing improvements in a trial short-term, like 6 months, let's call it medium-term, some weight loss, improvement in metrics, is very common, but we often see a rebound. People struggle to maintain their habits, and their problems tend to come back. So they stopped the intervention after 6 months. The group meetings and the coaching and the tip sheets in the control group, all that stuff stopped. They went back to their normal lives. They let time go, and then they checked in with them again later. 18 months later, so 2 years after the start of the trial, they did see some rebound of the habits. Vegetable intake and daily steps, still higher than the controls and still higher than baseline, than where they started, but definitely some decline. And sensory awareness, interestingly, stayed steady. But when we look at the metabolic syndrome remission results, that was really interesting. In the intense intervention group, almost 28% were now in remission from metabolic syndrome, and 21% in the controls, the less intense. So the numbers actually trended up, if anything. The individual metrics didn't change that much. Triglycerides rebounded in the intense group. They did go back up a bit. And waist circumference, maybe slight rebound. Mostly the other parameters stayed about stable. Now, of course, all the numbers we're looking at are the averages of everyone. So probably what happens is you have a lot of variability. You have a subpopulation of people that stuck better to the habits. They found this doable, maybe pleasant even. And those are probably the people who got the results. Those 28%, right, that got the remission. And then you have some other folks for whom this didn't work. They didn't really find it doable. Maybe they even got worse with time, which is the normal trend we see in Western populations. These metrics and the number of people with metabolic syndrome goes up with time. And those folks that didn't do well on the intervention might actually be the majority, might be 50 or 60%. And so that would explain why these individual metrics, the triglycerides, the waist circumference, the average of everyone, didn't get any better, even though the percentage of people that see remission of metabolic syndrome stays the same or even goes up a little. Okay, so how could we make this better? 28% of people fixing the issue, not bad at all, nothing to scoff at, but how could we get even more? I took a look at other trials that have been published on this question. People with metabolic syndrome trying to put that in remission with lifestyle. This number of 30-ish percent, common to see. Several other trials fell in the same ballpark. One meta-analysis put together 10 different randomized trials looking at this, and the average effect, they found 39% remission rate for metabolic syndrome. So not bad at all. And the specific interventions varied a lot from trial to trial. For example, one trial used stretching, strength training, and dancing as the exercise component, and the diet component was basically cutting 300 calories a day and eating more fruit, vegetables, low-fat dairy, and whole grains, and reducing fat, refined grains, sweets, and red meat. Another trial used yoga, stretching, dancing, and walking, and their diet was staying under 1,500 calories a day and under 60% of calories from carbs. And one last example, they used bike riding and a DASH diet, plus cutting out 600 calories a day. So different interventions, but you see some common points. And this meta-analysis found two really interesting things. The interventions that were the most successful, where they saw the highest rates of remission, tended to have two characteristics. One, their intervention was focused on weight loss, on achieving weight loss, often through caloric restriction, through cutting calories. Bear in mind, that doesn't necessarily mean that the participants are counting calories or even necessarily aware of the calories, but the intervention, the design of the diet and the exercise is meant to achieve a caloric deficit in the participants. And number two, the exercise component tended to be more than just walking, a more intense exercise program. And this really shines the light and matches really well with what I think is the main weakness of this new trial that we've been looking at, because the interventions are pretty mild, both of them. Even though we have a stronger, a more intense one, and a less intense one, both are pretty subtle. Having some veggies and taking walks and focusing on colors and smells, it's good advice, but it's unlikely to flip 80% of people with metabolic syndrome. These are pretty sick individuals. They usually have pretty bad diet, no physical activity, just bad habits in general. So this stuff is a good start. It's a good warm-up, maybe for like the first month or two. And hey, it worked for almost 30% of participants. That's not bad at all, right? Probably what happened is it worked for those that weren't so far gone. It worked for the folks that were more on the threshold. And those that are the nightmare cases need something more intense. So more food swaps, not just try to eat some veggies, but let's try to replace the soda or the hypercaloric foods that people are eating, the frozen pizza or the chicken nuggets or the sweets, whatever it is. Let's try to replace that with something less processed, this type of thing, a more complete overhaul of the diet. And same thing for the physical activity component. They can start with the brisk walks, but eventually they might need a bit more. Having a slightly more intensive workout than this, it doesn't need to be marathons, but just a little more cardio and lifting weights can have dramatic results, both on your lab work, and it can melt visceral fat. We covered all that. Check out the details in this previous video, and I'll see you in there.